This is the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast. I'm Oisin Langan. Coming up today, we've got Graham Gartland on a bad European night for Shamrock Rovers and their Dublin derby with Bohs this Sunday, while Alan Keane talks to us about Sligo Rovers' 7 defeats on the bounce. Stephen Kenny has named his squad for the trio of World Cup qualifiers against Portugal, Azerbaijan and Serbia. We'll examine that squad with ExtraTime.com's Tom O'Connor. Ireland have not made a good start to the group, and Stephen Kenny was asked if it's realistic to think we'll be in a good position after this block of matches.
We want to focus on Portugal first of all, and then we've got the two home games. We know we've not started well, although with the exceptional performance in Serbia can weigh empty-handed. And what we want to do is put in a strong performance against Portugal and certainly take that into the two home games. We're excited about the two home games as well. It'd be amazing for everyone to experience that, playing in front of the Irish support. I'm sure you're really passionate to be in the stadium, and they'll want to get behind the players, the supporters. We want to get behind the players, and that'll be special.
As well as all that, there's four-time All-Ireland winner with Kerry, Sean O'Sullivan, on the All-Ireland semi-final between the Kingdom and Tyrone. Former Cork star Paul Kerrigan on the Cork County final, in which he'll be playing. He'll be playing for Nemo Rangers. They'll be up against Castlehaven. He'll also look ahead to the Electric Ireland All-Ireland minor football final between Meath and Tyrone this Saturday. Ellen Keane once again deserves our praise, winning Paralympic gold in the 100 metres breaststroke in Tokyo. A more determined character you'll not meet. Hopefully we'll get to chat to her in the next couple of weeks. I was actually at the Paralympics in Rio and interviewed her a few times, and there's just this aura of grit that comes from her, and you just know how hard she's worked for this success. So congratulations to her and congratulations to her family. You probably saw the wonderful scenes across the last couple of days. I will also hear from Ireland Rugby captain Ciara Griffin on her involvement with the Tackle Your Feelings campaign in schools, as well as the upcoming World Cup qualification tournament in Italy. This is the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast, and we're joined by former Shamrock Rovers defender and, of course, analyst on the LOI TV Shamrock Rovers stream, Graham Gartland. Graham, it was a tough night for Shamrock Rovers in Tala last night, losing 1-0 to Flora on the night and going out 5-2 on aggregate. And the thing is they never really got going in the game, did they? They never really gave this one a shot.
Yeah, obviously they tried to come out of the blocks early and get tempo into the game, but it probably didn't lead to too many chances on goal. There was a couple of things fired across the box, and then Aaron Green probably walked out into wide areas and fired things into the box. But because he went into wide areas, he probably didn't have many people inside the area to maybe apply a finish to it. And then I thought around the 30-minute mark, Mandroyu got into the game a little bit and tried to bring a bit of a tempo to it. But yeah, there wasn't a lot of goal mount action that, you know, or a sustained period of pressure for Shamrock Rovers that could ultimately lead to a mistake or a goal. Normally, you know, you can tire a team out or you can wear them down, and eventually a mistake happens and you can nick a goal then by hemming the team in and keeping them, stopping them from getting out, stop their counterattacks, that they can't relieve pressure, that ultimately then the pressure can tell and it can lead to a goal either by really good play or by a mistake from them through tiredness. And I agree with you. I don't think Shamrock Rovers probably had that sustained period of pressure to maybe force a mistake or to produce a moment where they could get back into the game with a goal.
And the very frustrating thing is they really shouldn't have conceded that goal. It was a bad mistake from Manus. It was a mistake from Andreu in the lead up to it. And Stephen Bradley actually said on his TV interview on RTE that he was just about to take off Mandreu. So it was just an unfortunate set of circumstances.
Yeah, I think Mandroyu, because I was at the game, and I think Mandroyu picked up a little bit of a hip injury, and it was right in front of us, and he was holding his hip early doors, and it looked like he was struggling to sort of maybe run. He gives the ball away, and he actually goes to press it straight away, but obviously Rovers are trying to get back into the game, and they're a little bit open, and that leads to a counter-attack, and Valiev just waits to pass again, lovely, and Sapinen hits a shot. And like we had discussed, you know, Alan Manus would normally save that 9 times out of 10. He just gets down, picks her up. He's, you know, and he's already throwing the ball out and getting an attack going for Rovers. So it's such a disappointing goal to concede, considering, like you said, the time of the game as well, where Rovers are hoping that they can have a last big half hour and push into the south stand and get the crowd up behind them and, you know, try and get them over. But it gave them three goals to even force the penalties, and I think that's when sort of just sapped that little bit of, wouldn't say belief, but sapped that sort of, I would say belief, sapped that belief out of the fact that, you know, this is possible or capable of doing it.
It wasn't a great night in Tallaght last night, but this one really was lost in the first leg, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think to concede four goals in Europe and any, like, if you're conceding four goals over the two legs, it's tough enough, but to concede four over the first leg, I think you're giving yourself an awful lot to do, for loads of different reasons. I done the commentary on the first game and I thought Rovers actually performed really well at times in the game, but they were sucker punched a couple of times on the counter-attack, and especially the last goal kills them. So to concede four in one game, for two reasons, it knocks you, is you have an uphill task in the next leg, but the other team will always feel that they have a chance to score as well. So you're giving them a little bit more belief and a little bit of momentum going into the next tie. So for that, in that sense, it's sort of a double blow, because Florida Tallaght came and done a job tonight, and that they were really, really professional in what they done. They set in, they covered areas really well. Areas that Shamrock Rovers liked was exploit. The boys Sommets and Miller done a really, really good job in the inside left and the inside right channel, where the likes of Androu, Bourke, Tell, when he comes on, likes to operate, and they just got across and plugged them holes really well. The fullbacks were really, really good tonight. They stopped any joy from Scales or Finn. They covered in if Bourke or Androu tried to run in between them, or if Aaron Green tried to run in between the centre back and the fullback. So I think they deserve to go through over the two legs in the game. Or out in the tie, sorry.
Now, Shamrock Rovers have a Dublin derby on Sunday away to Bohemians in the Cup. Is that the ideal game to have next and so soon, or do you think they'd rather have a few days more of a rest and a few days more to shake off the negativity and all that? Or what's the situation there?
To be honest, Oisin, whether they'd rather or not, I think it's just something you have to get on with. Like, that's the... When you're as successful as Rovers have been over the last two seasons, you know, games are going to come thick and fast and you don't get to pick them. So, but it's a Dublin derby. I think over the course of the last two seasons, the record that Stevens had against Bohemians has been really, really good. And I think he's just gone, well, it's about getting results, and especially in a cup game as well. I think it's just about going there and getting a result. But no matter how you do it, if you do it by playing great football, brilliant. If you do it by, you know, catching them on the counter attack, great. But once you get the result, to make sure you're in the next leg or in the next sort of draw, that's all Stephen would be worried about. And again, they can't feel sorry for themselves. They just have to go and go to Bohemians and put on a performance that gets them through into the Cup.
And it's likely it will be without Liam Scales. How big a loss will he be for Shamrock Rovers for the rest of the season?
Yeah, I think it'll be a big loss. I think I've been really impressed from the I've seen him more closely in the last probably 3 months than and again, he just gives them so much on the left-hand side. He's actually a threat in the box at the back post when they're attacking on the right-hand side. He's a threat. You've seen that against Longford. Technically, he's really good. He very rarely coughs up the ball that much. Defensively, he's sound. 1v1s, 1v1 confrontations, he's really, really good. He gets back in and covers well. He can get up and down the pitch, but he offers them a lot more versatility as well. He can play left side and centre back if he ever needed to go to a four. He can play left back and left side and left centre back of a four. So his versatility is great as well. But I just think he brings a calmness to that left hand side and a really good presence as well. So I think it'd be a big miss. Like But I know Cavan is a really good player as well. And obviously they have Lee Grace to come back in too. Sean Hoare went down with an injury tonight. It looked like he maybe hurt his groin playing a pass. So be interesting to see how that one turns out when it gets scanned. But yeah, it looks like it'd be a bigger loss with the fact that Grace is out and it looks like Hoare will be out as well.
Okay. Well, look, a bad night for Shamrock Rovers last night. They'll hope for a better weekend when they take on Bohemians on Sunday afternoon in the FAI Cup in the Evoke.ie FAI Cup kicking off at 4 o'clock. We'll have reaction to that game on the Monday podcast. But for now, Graham Gartland of Shamrock Rovers, or formerly of Shamrock Rovers and still of the Shamrock Rovers stream on LOI TV, and of course, a coach at the club. Thank you very much for joining us on the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast.
Thanks, Oisin.
This is the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast, and we're joined now by Tom O'Connor of ExtraTime.com. Earlier on, Tom, we heard Stephen Kenny talking about his squad and, well, more so about the week ahead and the fact that he is positive going into the games against Portugal, Azerbaijan and Serbia. The game against Portugal away from home, Azerbaijan and Serbia come to the Aviva. Regards the squad selection, there might be a debate or two, there always is, but there's no real surprise, is there?
Nothing massive, Oisin, from what we can see. Like, look, most of the talk going on is around the midfield and the guys who've been picked in midfield. I know, look, we've spoken a lot about Gavin Kilkenny, who's playing regularly for Bournemouth, but look, by trade, he would have been a winger. Naturally, he's now playing a more central role for Bournemouth, so he's still learning his game. Look, he's very young as well, so while he has earned a lot of praise recently, the reality is that he hasn't got the same amount invested in the bank, I suppose, as the likes of Hendrick, Conor Hur and Harry Arthur, Jace Mullumby. They're not playing as regularly, but they all would have a relationship built up with Stephen Kenny over the years. In terms of actual playing regular in midfield, you know, the guys were selected in the squad, Jamie McGrath, obviously, you know, he had a great season with Samirin last season. And you have Josh Cullen, who was playing for Anderlecht against Vitesse last night, just beating Somin. He's playing European style football. So, you know, they're the major midfielders is probably where most of the conversation lies. You look at the defence, Seamus Coleman, Premier League regular. You have Matt Doherty, who was playing last night for Spurs against Pacas Ferreira in Europe again. And look, we've seen the re-emergence of Shane Duffy. There's been a lot of conversation there. So there's three of your back four who are playing in the Premier League. You have John Egan, who was playing there last year. Again, Darrow Shea, they're both playing regularly Championship. Ronan Manning is now playing in a different position for Swansea. He's playing more central in their defence. So look, that adds another string to his bow. And then obviously, look, James McLean, I mean, there's very little that Stephen Kenny's going to learn from James McLean. He brought him into Derry way back as a teenager, gave him his debut in club football or in League of Ireland football. Like, so these guys are in defence are as regular as they come. Very few surprises there. Look, it's great to see Nathan Collins made his Burnley debut last week, and Andrew Mandeli played for Norwich in the EFL Cup, in their EFL Cup win during the week. So look, you have Nathan Collins, we spoke before about the size of the transfer fee. He obviously has huge promise. Omobamadele has been on the bench for Norwich. He's in round Premier League squad. So there's not much else there that hasn't featured. Darren Randolph, I suppose the fact that he has so many caps, but the reality is he's only played three Premier League games in the last 12 months. He hasn't featured in a Premier League squad this season. He's third choice at West Ham. Kevin Kelleher, yes, he's not playing. You know, when you look at the likes of Gavin Bazuna, who's currently in the number one jersey, playing great stuff for Portsmouth. Mark Travers is playing regularly for Bournemouth. Kevin Keller's on the bench, but again, he's in around a Premier League environment, and Klopp isn't afraid to throw him in like we saw last year when he threw him into the Champions League. That brings us to the forwards.
We'll come back to the forwards in just a moment, but there would be a worry around midfield that of the players that are named, not too many of them are playing regularly. Now, granted, when you look at the actual official FAI graphic, McLean is down as a defender when obviously he can go into midfield, but Hendrick, Horahan, Mullumby, McGrath, Arthur and Cullen not playing at the moment. Alan Brown, it's possible that he could come back for the second and third games. Interestingly enough, it's the same with Callan Robinson, but I don't think Brown has actually played a whole pile at this season from what I can see. I beg your pardon, he's played three times. What am I talking about? But is there a worry about midfield and the fact that there's a lot of players there who are not playing a whole lot of football, even though it is early in the season?
Look, there is that. You have to look at it that if some players are selected on form and other players are selected with credit in the bank, where does it lie? Look, and the majority of this squad seem to be selected with money in the bank. Like you say, these guys are experienced internationals. Conor Hurahan, an experienced international, but at the end of the day, he's been farmed out to Swansea now. He had a great season with Swansea, don't get me wrong, last season, but he's sitting at Villa in the Premier League. He actually captained them last week and he got an assist. They won 6-0 in the AFL Cup. Harry Arter played an hour for Forest under 23s. Brighton, there was talk of
but that's under 23s, Tom. I know he's played, but that is not the standard we need these guys to be playing at, is it?
Oh, no, I agree with you. Sorry, I apologise if I'm coming across that way. No, that these guys are playing at the standard whereby it's not as competitive. Like I say, a 6-0 win in the AFL Cup is not a competitive outing that you want then to be stepping into an international campaign. So, yeah, no, I agree. And look, maybe Stephen Kenny's obviously looking at it that these guys have done it for me in the past. I want them to do it in the future. There's the argument that Gavin Kilkenny could he step up because he's in good form at the minute. I could Jamie McGrath get a start in place because, could your central start midfield be Josh Cullen and Jamie McGrath because these guys are playing regularly and are in good form? I don't know. I'm not.
Yeah. Look, the thing about Stephen Kenny is he will pick the team he feels is right and not the team he feels we think is right. Does that make sense? He doesn't feel pressure from the outside. He'll go with what he thinks is right. You mentioned there the forwards, and I unfortunately blocked your path. So you can go back to the forwards now. We've got Connolly, Josh Collins, Ida, Horgan, Curtis, Long, and Parrott.
Yeah, look, like you say, guys who haven't played. James Collins subbed against Brighton in the Cup, came on as a sub against Cardiff. We know what kind of a player he is. Adam Ida is in the same or a similar position to Andrew Amadeli at Norwich, whereby Daniel Farke obviously rates him highly enough not to let him go out on loan. But by the same token, he's not starting and not getting a lot of minutes. Then you drop down, you're going down to League One, where the likes of Parrott, Ronan Curtis and Darren Horgan are operating. They're operating in the same league as Anthony Scully and Aidan O'Brien, who both scored hat-tricks in the Cup last week, but aren't close to the squad, aren't mentioned in the squad. I know Stephen Kenny mentioned a number of players from the League of Ireland who are in and around the squad, in and around his thoughts for the squad coming, if there are pullouts or anything. Look, we know with COVID at the minute, who knows what's going to happen. But, I mean, there wasn't a mention, to the best of my knowledge, of Anthony Scully or Aidan O'Brien, who, like I say, both netted hat-tricks during the week. Scully's in really good form for Lincoln, and they're operating in the same division as the likes of Troy Parrott, Ronan Curtis, Daryl Horgan are there. So it's interesting there. Shane Long, again, is probably similar to the guys in midfield. He's not kicking a lot of ball. He played 26 minutes for Southampton. They won 8-0 in the Cup last week against Sunderland. That probably says a lot. We know what he can do. We know he's capable of it, but he's probably more closer to the end of his career. In fact, he is. Let's call a spade. He's closer to the end of his career than the start of his career. So you're looking at probably the likes of Aaron Connolly maybe starting and, Adam Ada starting, and neither of them haven't started in the Premier League this season.
Okay. Well, you mentioned there that Stephen Kenny did reference some League of Ireland players. Let's hear exactly what he said.
Like Liam Scales is sort of next one in on the left side. James McLean and Ryan Manning obviously have played a lot of games in that position. Liam, it's a new position for Liam, left wing back. He's always been a left centre back, and I played him left back, in fact, against Italy with the under 21s. He played that game, and even at that time, he's really developed at Shamrock Rovers very well this year and scored some very good goals. So He's probably next one in relation to that position at the moment. With James and obviously Ryan Manning's done very well for Swansea, you know, in that position, has played it for a couple of years now. It's a relatively new position for Liam. Michael Duffy, the other one, was pushing strong at the felt, and was very close to the squad, and could still feature over the three games, depending on how it goes.
So it seems that Mikey Duffy and Liam Scales are not too far away. And Stephen Bradley, speaking after the Rovers game last night, the Rovers defeat, unfortunately, said that, you know, Scales has likely played his last game for the club, so he seems to be on his way to Celtic. But can Duffy and Scales feel unfortunate not to be in the initial draft of players in the squad?
Well, look, I suppose, like, Liam Scales is most likely going to be called into the Ireland squad within the next, we'll say, 6 months. Mm-hmm. And then the whole magic playing argument is going to come up, I think. I think that's just probably kind of more unfortunate, the fact that he's not staying at Shamrock Rovers long enough to be getting his call up. Look, and at left, you know, on the left side of defence, we're very strong, we're well equipped there. And look, Stephen Kenny made reference to it in that press conference. And if you even look at the squad, you look at the likes, James McLean can play on the left hand side of defence. Ronan Manning can play on the left-hand side of the fence. We know Matt Doherty was trying to be shoehorned into the left-hand side of the fence. And then if you're going to play Liam Scales more centrally, Ronan Manning is playing there for Swansea at the moment. And we have, you know, we have the partnership of Shane Duffy and John Egan, who are ready centrally, who are central defenders, who are established central defenders, and Dar O'Shea at international level as well. So look, his time will come, but it would take an injury at the moment for him to feature in this round of, you know, like say in this trio of games.
Okay, well, there'll be a challenge, but hopefully Ireland can rise to the challenge, and hopefully Stephen Kenny can get a break, because he just hasn't had a break in this job yet between injuries and COVID. And, you know, speaking of COVID, Callum Robinson and Alan Brown are out of the squad. Actually, I can't remember offhand if Alan Brown is out because he's a close contact or because of an injury. I think it's because he's a close contact anyway. Either way, he's out, but they could come back into the squad for the last two games in Dublin next week. Tom O'Connor of ExtraTime.com, thank you very much for joining us on the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast. And we'll talk to you on Monday when we'll round up the Irish in the UK.
Production, talk to them.
I wonder at times why we even get him like this game. You know, we've been far the better side. We've been undone with two set players.
I think that's frustration on the Sligo Rovers' part, certainly, at having lost here tonight. It's finished Sligo Rovers 1, Hafnar Fjordur 2 on the night, and Hafnar Fjordur emerge as 3-1 winners on aggregate in the UEFA Europa.
Throw comes in to Brian Whitmarsh. Once again, it comes to Keane Coleman. He lays it off, and it's in the back of the net! Look like they have stolen that.
Just,
oh my word.
This is just a disaster. It would be a soft way to go out of the cup, and very, very disappointing. You gotta love all of me. You gotta love deeper than that.
Now if you're gonna leave me, you better run far away. And it's another defeat for Sligo Rovers. Rovers now will take on Derry City. That's their next game. It's been a tale of two seasons. It had been a great first half before the break. After the break, six defeats in a row. Their 7-point gap is now down to 4. And there's real pressure on Liam Buckley's men.
Yeah, absolutely. And look, at the start of the season, would you have taken where they are now? Absolutely. But it's a difficult period. They need to dig in. They need to work hard. They need to win ugly.
And there's the whistle for the end of the match. And for the 7th match in a row, Sligo Rovers have been beaten. And that will hurt everybody, the players, the management and the supporters.
This is the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast. And that is some commentary clips from Oisin FM of Sligo's recent poor run. They've lost 7 in a row. A former Sligo player Alan Keane has been at most of those games commentating for the LOI TV Sligo stream. Alan, how are you?
Good, Oisin, and yourself?
What's gone wrong?
Look, you know, it's hard to put a pinpoint on it, but I did speak in a couple of podcasts previously earlier in the season that the European game will be a telling time for Sligo Rovers. And I think ever since that European game, where they actually played quite well in that European game, especially at home, but then they just fell apart in the second half, a late goal in the first half. And then ever since that, then it's just has spiraled downhill. And I suppose it might sound daft, but it was when the fans started coming back in, you know. I don't think they've won a game since the fans came back in. So you wonder, is that extra pressure on the players or what? But you know, obviously a couple of injuries here and there. Greg Bulger, obviously a big loss. But it's hard to pinpoint it, and there's doesn't look to be something, you know, not right within the squad, because, you know, you have Jordan Gibson, who's gone off the boil a good bit, who had an exceptional start to the year, and other players, but the likes of Gary Buckley still playing really, really well, along with John Mahan. But I think we're lacking up top, and thankfully recently Liam Buckley now has strengthened the attack, you know, and hopefully the likes of Andrew Wright and Melvin Lorenzo or the Ugandan international, hopefully they can produce, because you got to look at it, it's not all doom and gloom. Sligo Rovers third in the table, two games in hand to Derry City and two games in hand to St. Pat's. You know, Derry are a point behind them. So it's all good. It's still good, even though after the bad run of results. And I think maybe this weekend off will probably help them massively to regroup and get anyone that has niggling injuries back on the pitch.
Is there a defensive issue that's causing problems? Is it the fact that Greg Bulger has been missing? And we've seen that no matter who he plays for, be it Shamrock Rovers or Cork City in the past and St. Pat's, he holds a team together. He's kind of like the glue in the middle. What would you put it down to, this bad run?
It's definitely not a defence issue, because they're the best defence in the league. Okay. The thing with Rovers is they've actually played in games where they've had most of the possession. They've had, say, 60-40 possession, but actually didn't really create much with it, and then get done with a sucker punch. And you go back to the Cork City Cup game. They were all over Cork. They went 1-0 up. You know, I'd done the radio that time, and I said, oh, look, at Rovers are going to look to push on. This could be 3 or 4-0. And they had loads of possession, created nothing after that, and then Cork went up and equalised. And from then on, it only looked like one team was going to win the game, and that was Cork City. So it's the same in other games. Look at Derry, the last game I've done for Watch LOI and the stream. Derry started really well, then Rovers came into the game, and then second half, Rovers were excellent, loads of possession, had one or two chances, and then got caught with a sucker punch at the end. But I think it's the creativity in the final third. They do really well defensively. They're solid. I think Gary Buckley and John Mahan are exceptional, two of them at centre-back, and Lewis Banks, and whether it be Colm Horgan or Regan Donlan at left-back, but with Bulger in front of them. But it's just, I think the creativity up top, the lads haven't clicked properly. You know, loads of possession, but just finishing off them chances or creating them chances. So hopefully the likes of Andrew Wright comes in and kicks off straight away and goes on, you know, because you're kind of relying on the likes of Johnny Kinney, who's only a young lad who should be, you know, coming off the bench here and there, but you're nearly wanting him now to start every game, and it's a lot on his young shoulders. Romeo hasn't done well at all, whatever reason. He looks like, to me, he looks like a player that doesn't want to be here. And you know, so whether that has a factor, and he looks like a player that's lacking in confidence also.
Well, Liam Buckley has reacted, as you said, he's gone out into the transfer market and signed players. And they're guys who look to me like they're strong players, literally and metaphorically. Is that exactly what Sligo need up top? Because you mentioned there that Kenny has been getting a lot of game time, but he is just a child. And good as he is, you know, he is not a man to hold up a ball, perhaps. He is a man to stretch defences, but you need something else.
Yeah, 100%. You need a good player up there that can, you know, hold the ball up, bring players in into play, and then, you know, get on the score sheet, get in the box. I don't think, you know, there was a stage at the Cork City game where I was frustrated. The ball went wide and there was no one making runs into the box. And you're like, you're not going to score if you don't, you know, crosses coming in the box. They're like, you know, it was frustrating to watch. So Stephen, Liam Buckley has reacted in the transfer. You know, I was getting a bit worried that he wouldn't be able to bring in anyone. So I think they're two good signings. Hopefully they hit the ground running. And the likes of, you know, I suppose I go back to Jordan Gibson. His best period of the season was at the start of the year, and for the first, when they went on a run, was when he was playing out wide right. He was taking on defenders 1v1. He was creating loads of chances. Since he's gone into the middle, I don't think he's performed to the level that we know he can do, because I think players are kind of, you know, he's playing more so when he's back to goal rather than running at a defender. And I think when you have the league that we have, and we have the good midfielders in the league, they just sit on him and they don't give him the space. And straight away, that's eliminating one of your best players out of the game. So it'd be interesting to see whether he moves out to the right, back out to the right, and maybe the likes of Andrew Wright and that Melvin Lorenzo or that Ugandan fella plays off him. So they also have Walter Figueroa. So it'll be interesting. Liam will have, you know, good options there. But I also, you have to kind of, I suppose, question Liam as well. Some of the decisions and I suppose substitutions that he made. You know, especially I go back to the Cork City game again, where he brought on Walter and Johnny Kinney with 2 minutes of injury time played. I was actually baffled, because I actually thought that the substitutions were already made, and I didn't expect any more. And then I seen the two lads, and it was very late in the time. But look, Liam is an experienced man. We don't know what goes on in the training ground, whether lads at Niggles or Knox, but he's been there. Look, as I said, they're going through a rough patch. They're still third in the table, and it's theirs. You know, they're still in the driving seat, and hopefully they can gather the results and get back to where they were at the start of the year.
I'm not sure if you've ever been part of a team that have gone on such a bad run and then corrected it, but if you have been, can you tell us about your experience and how one might get something like this right?
Yeah, I've had it, I suppose. In 2009, under Paul Cook, we had a disastrous year, and we just couldn't get the confidence. And it's what happens when your confidence gets knocked. Every game rolls, you want the next game, and then, you know, the fans get impatient. And I think back in 2015, we were lucky with the results that we got. We stayed up the second last game of the season. We had such a squad that year, but it doesn't matter what kind of squad you have. It's about, you know, you need leaders and you need characters within that squad. And we had certainly had that. And we just, you know, you got together as a team, you rolled up your sleeves and you go, hey, listen, what are we at here? Like, there's something not right, whether it be maybe doing an extra session during the week to correct things. Where's it going wrong in games? You know, do the strikers have to wait back? Do the midfielders have to wait back for extra sessions to create? And I'm sure the likes of John Russell, and John has been around the block, of played with John. He's an exceptional pro. And Liam Buckley, I'm sure they're probably doing that at the minute. And as I said, this weekend off is probably a blessing for them, because they'll probably work twice as hard. And it's a massive, massive game against Drogheda. Because if they beat Drogheda, they go 8 points clear of Drogheda, and also have two games in hand to Drogheda. So that could really rule out, you know, Drogheda getting up towards European spot, because Bowser and Derry are certainly breathing down their necks.
Is it a disaster for Sligo if they don't get into Europe from here, from the position they're in?
Oh, 100%. And I won't say it any other way. It's they were up, and it kind of did annoy me. People were like, muting them for a title challenge. They hadn't got the squad for it, and you could see it. And as I said earlier, the European game will tell a lot, and it did. When a lot of the lads all throughout the start of the year, they all played, he nearly had the same team for the first 11, 12 games, and that was never going to work throughout the whole year. So I think it'd be an absolute disaster financially for the club and for the position that they've actually put themselves in earlier on in the year. and to lose out in a European spot. And I'm not even sure if fourth it'll be good enough for a European spot this year, you know. So you have Dundalk, who are right in the down at the bottom. You know, they could go on and win the FAI Cup, and fourth doesn't work. So I think it's the next couple of games are going to tell a lot on Sligo Rovers season. You know, they've drawed a Pats, Dundalk twice, I think, when a reschedule game, and I think Shamrock Rovers in a reschedule game. So it's going to be a massive, massive couple of weeks. And as you said, if they don't get Europe, it'll be disastrous. It'll be a poor, poor year.
And is it a matter of players needing to get used to the fans being back? Like, I was going to say, how do you do that? But I don't think any precedent exists, does it? Because we've never had a situation where fans were gone and now they're back.
No, we've never had that. And plus, the lads that had signed this year never really, I suppose, you know, experienced the fans. And especially in Sligo, the fans are so close to the pitch. And at that European game, there was only 400, but the noise was something else. And, you know, there's certain players there that they're still only young lads and they're new to the club. And you do feel a bit of pressure. And then obviously social media, you know, lads go on after games and, you know, I used to know a lot of lads that go on after games and they'd be, oh, this fella said this fella said that. And you're trying to say, forget about all that stuff.
And focus is that really, on the game. Do players really get affected by that? I mean, like, if it's someone like yourself who criticises them, fair enough, like your credentials are there, you know, 2 League of Ireland titles, 3 FAI Cups, you've played the game. But if it's someone like me, you know, I tweet about games, but players shouldn't listen to me. But do they pick up on any kind of criticism?
Oh, they do. And that's, I think, where you need your characters in your dressing rooms, where you just pull the lads, especially the younger lads or the lads that, you know, everyone loves praise when they're doing well. And I think I mentioned this on the TV the last night, that it's all great when you're doing well and you're getting the praise, but you have to be able to take the criticism as well. And I would say after games where, you know, yourself, your own self-critic, like you come in after a game, you don't need someone to turn around and say you've done well, and you go, I didn't do well, I was horrendous tonight, or you know when you play well, you know when you play bad. And people go on social media and it definitely does affect players, because we've had it in my time where lads come in and, dear, this fella said this about me and that fella said that about me, and you're just kind of like, will you forget about it? They go home, they're entitled to their opinions, but it's how you put it right the next day. And some players have the strong mentality, others have a little bit of a, you know, they get a bit, I suppose, hurt by it. And that's where you kind of have to, you know, grab the lads and say, listen, cop on, maybe stay off that for a couple of months, or never mind the negativity. You know, they read the papers, what's the paper said about them. But yet, they love reading the papers when they're doing well. So you still have to take the good with the bad. And that's where your strong mentality comes in. And I think maybe now with a little bit of negativity around Rovers camp at the minute, and they're not doing well, and fans going on saying this is not good enough, and that, I think it probably does affect, because there's a lot of there's a few younger lads in the squad. So I'm sure the likes of Bulger and the more senior pros, and even John Russell, assistant, would be telling the lads to lay off it for a while until you get back to winning ways.
And not specifically relating to Sligo here, but is there any point now in telling players stay off social media, because you know they won't? So do you then have to teach them how to handle it and how to react when they see negative comments, especially if they're negative comments from people who they shouldn't be listening to, who haven't kind of earned the right to have an opinion, or an opinion that should be listened to?
Yeah, like, and at the end of the day, it's an open platform. People are entitled to, you know, I've had it in my time where I might have had a good game and you go on and you see people criticizing you and you go, oh, fair enough. That just, to me, that used to drive me on, and I go, right, I'll prove you wrong next week, and I'll do this, I'll do that. But for players nowadays, I think they're very, how would I say, mollycoddles, a lot of them, and they want all good. And it is important for them to go back. It's down to the personality of the player. If you're not able to take it, stay off it. And if you're not able to take that criticism and or whatever criticism it comes, because fans are entitled to their opinion, regardless of whether they play the sport or not. They still go to a game and they'll tell you, some fans say, we're paying your wages. And fair enough, you know, and that's their opinion. But for me, it used to drive me on if I got criticism. And you could, as I said, you could be playing against a rival team and you'd be getting criticism. Like, this is where it used to go over my head. But for younger lads nowadays who are social media conscious, I think it's massive. You know, they'll go on after a game if they scored a goal or two goals or played a good game, and they'll probably type in their name. They'll see loads of things. The next week they might have an absolute stinker, and they'll go on, they'll check that, and then they'll take the more negative comments rather than looking at the positive comments and go, well, hang on a minute, I just had a blip. I'm going to prove myself wrong, prove myself right next week. Yeah. But unfortunately, it's hard to get that out of lads' mentality. And that's there's a lot of young lads in around the league, and social media can be a rough place. And you've seen it with the Euros, with the English players. You know, and I always just say, I call them keyboard warriors. Yep. You know, say it to your face. They wouldn't be able to say it to your face. You know, walk up. I had never any issue when I was playing. Walk up and say it to my face. And I go, accept your opinion, move on. That's it. Yep. But nowadays, people are hiding behind, you know, social media platforms under fake names, and lads get too bogged into it. And unless that's done, something's done about it, it'll never change. And that's where maybe clubs maybe have to educate their players, which I know they have, and I think PFEI do a bit as well. So I think it's important to educate, especially the younger lads coming through, that don't leave everything you hear and read on social media, because these are majority of the people are just jealous fellas that never could play the game or didn't get it that far, and they're hiding behind an egg or something, you know.
That's right. And I think anyone on social media has to be careful, because as you say, fans pay their money for streams and pay their money for tickets, so they're entitled to an opinion, but that doesn't mean players should seek the approval of those people. As James Lowe, the Leinster and Ireland winger, said to me recently, he said, if someone's number isn't in my phone, then I'm not going to listen to their opinion. In other words, the coaches and those around him are the ones that he really needs to listen to, and he must try and block out the noise. And then, like, you know, you've got the debate on Twitter and Facebook and TikTok, whatever. I'm not on TikTok, but I'm sure there is debates. Where, you know, fans can reasonably talk about football, but then there is that other side of it that you mentioned, the ugly side of people hiding behind pseudonyms and just being there just to be an a-hole, basically. And that's hard for players to handle. And I often think young players don't separate the genuine debate from the keyboard warriors, as you call them. Look, Alan, that's something we could talk about all day. Really, really glad to have had you on the show and to get your opinion on Sligo Rovers and their recent poor run. But it sounds to me like you're confident that they can get it right. And with the talent they have and the players they've just signed, I think you're absolutely correct. Alan Keane, thanks for joining us on the extratime.com Friday podcast.
Thanks a million, Oisin, for having me.
This is the extratime.com Friday podcast. And I'm now joined by four-time All-Ireland winner with Kerry, Sean O'Sullivan. Sean, not just four All-Ireland medals for you, but now also you have the prestige of being a Division 4 footballer. a good week for you and the club. Tell me about it. Cromain promoted to Division 4.
Yeah, good start to the week. I suppose end of the week, really, Oisin. Yeah, so we've been trying for quite a while to get out of the basement of Kerry football, I suppose, when it comes to the league system down here. There's five divisions for your listeners who might know about the county league system in Kerry. There's five divisions, and my club, Cremorne, I suppose, we've been a bit of a yo-yo club to take West Brom's mantle there. We've been jumping up and down between five and four for a bit, and unfortunately, it's been more in five in the last, I suppose, 6 or 7 years. So we've been trying desperately to jump up into four, and thankfully on Wednesday night we won our promotion playoff against a tough, hardy Ballyduff team. So we're thrilled, Oisin. We've a nice young team. Alan O'Neill came in there as our manager a couple of years ago, and obviously, look, with COVID and everything, it's been a bit disruptive, but we seem to have a nice blend of youth and experience at the moment, and we put in an excellent performance on Wednesday night under the lights in Austin Stack Park. So it was a great occasion for a lot of our younger players to play in there as well. So we got the job done, and hopefully now onto bigger and better things as we go forward.
I can only imagine what it's like as a Division 5 and next year a Division 4 team to come up against you guys and see you and Dunica Walsh in midfield. That is some pairing in the engine room, isn't it?
Well, I don't know about that. But look, it's great. Look, I've played in the forwards all my career for the club, Oisin, and I suppose when Alan came in, he just sat me down and said, "Look, you have to." And he's right, you know. And you can ask any footballer, you know, coming to the end of their career, you know, late 30s, early 40s, which I am. You have to enjoy it, Oisin. It's, you know, I've been lucky enough, and Dunnock is lucky enough that we had fantastic days out with Kerry. But, you know, when you're playing with your club there, you just have to enjoy it. Of course, you put pressure on yourself to perform and help the team, but it's all about enjoying it. And he just sat me down at the start of the year, Alan, and asked me, "Look, I'm thinking about putting you out around the middle where we can get you on the ball a lot more. You know, playing inside in the forwards, I suppose you're kind of a marked man and you're double teamed, and with packed defences, it's hard to get space." So he just saw a role for me out the field, kind of complimenting Dunica. I suppose Dunica still has that massive engine to be able to get up and down the field. Mine probably isn't there anymore, but I'm more of a link man now to move the ball through the middle and get it into some of our young scoring forwards, which is great. And I have to say, on Wednesday night, it worked a treat. You know, we were able to get our hands on the ball around the middle and move it into these young guys with pace, and they're hungry, and they did the damage on the scoreboard. So look, it was a great night for the club, and hopefully a few more to come before I hang up the boots, Oisin.
Well, congratulations to you and the club, and I know you're coaching away as well, and we'll get into that at some stage in the future. We might come back to Kerry because the club championship will start sooner rather than later. You hope a bit later. You hope it's after a Kerry All-Ireland final win, but they have to get there first, and they're up against Tyrone this weekend. How disruptive has the delay been, or will we only know that when we see Kerry out on the pitch? Because this has not been in any way ideal for them.
It hasn't. No, it's been very disruptive. But I think Kerry have played it well. You know, I think there was never any doubt that Kerry wanted this game played. They could understand where Tyrone were coming from. It was unfortunate. It was frustrating for Kerry. But there was never any doubt or never any question down here that this game, that Kerry would ever decide to take a walk over or buy into a final. It's not our style. And look, I think Tyrone people, you know, can... You know, from the sound bites coming out of Tyrone, they appreciate that. And I think it's great that the game is being played. It's been disruptive for both teams, of course. Look, the Tyrone thing is obvious with the cases they had through COVID. You know, that's been dissected now and talked about enough. But I suppose from the Kerry point of view, Oisin, it has. I mean, it's going to be 5 weeks since they played Cork. You know, that's an enormous amount of time for any player to try and prepare themselves to hit the ground running in an All-Ireland semi-final. You know, I suppose the fact that they thought the game was fixed and they were able to build themselves up and get ready to peak for the game, and then be told that it was off, and then be told that it was going to be another week's delay, it's not ideal. But look, at the end of the day, these fellas are part of very, very professional inter-county setups. They've got very, very good management teams. They've got excellent backroom teams. They've nutritionists. They've sports scientists. You know, nowadays, all these eventualities and these bumps in the road that occur, you know, are dealt with brilliantly. And, you know, just from hearing little bits and pieces from the Kerry camp, you don't hear much, but the little bits and pieces you are hearing is that the players are fine. Of course, they're a little bit peeved of what's gone on and why it's been so delayed, but it hasn't really affected their mindset or affected their preparation. In fact, for a couple of guys, it's given them an opportunity to get a little bit more training into the legs, particularly Dermot O'Connor, who got a bad bang against Cork and would have been probably a doubt if the Tyrone game had gone ahead when it should have. And Dara Meinhan as well falls into that bracket. So they've got a little bit of extra time to get themselves right. Now, would the two of them have been starting anyway? I'm not sure. Maybe Dermot O'Connor, probably. We'll have to wait and see when the teams are named. But it has given those type of guys the opportunity to get back into the fold. So from that point of view, it's been a positive. There's been a lot of negative talk about it. But to be honest with you, I don't think it's going to really have a bearing on Kerry's performance. They'll be ready to go. Their internal games have gone quite well again, from what I'm hearing. So once the ball is thrown in tomorrow, Oisin, at half past three above in Croke Park, these guys will be ready to go. I've no doubt about it.
How do you think Kerry might set up? And is it a case of Peter Keane trying to double guess what Tyrone do? Because Tyrone were so open in that league match and Kerry scored 6 goals. And Tyrone in the Ulster Championship have been lucky enough to be at all their games. Were, compared to what they had been under Mickey Hart, relatively open. But if they're open against Kerry, Kerry will rip them apart. So how do Kerry set up for this game?
Okay, well, I think Kerry are going to have to look. I know people are referring to the league match. Without my Yerraism on here and going down that road, you can't read too much into that. And I don't want to sound like Peter Keane and his famous comments, you know, that, you know, it should have been closer than the scoreline suggested. But Kerry were very good that day. They were excellent. Their forwards were absolutely, you know, on top of the ground. And it was great to see. It was great to see. And look, hopefully, I don't think so, but hopefully they'll be able to bring that as well on tomorrow. But Kerry are going to have to be very careful here, because I was at a loose end yesterday and I actually popped on the All-Ireland semi-final from 2019, Oisin, Kerry, Tyrone and Croke Park. And okay, you can say, well, look, that was a Mickey Hart team and different management now, and they're looking to go at Kerry differently and so on. But I think if Brian Duher looks at that video again, Kerry were in all amounts of trouble from Tyrone dropping in back behind the ball, breaking fast and leaving 2-on-2, 3-on-3 inside the full forward line. And if you look at Tyrone and Monaghan in the Ulster final, Tyrone played a very similar game. They got in behind the ball and they trusted that Matty Donnelly and McCurry would stay high up the field in one-on-one situations, and they got the ball in there very direct and very fast. And they were very, very, they got a lot of joy out of it. If you look at the 2019 semi-final against Kerry, they did very, very similar. It's something very similar. They let the ball in fast into one-on-one situations. You had Cathal McShane, who was obviously flying at the time, so he is obviously still kind of coming back from that injury. He was one-on-one with Jason Foley. He gave Jason Foley a torrid time. Tadhg Morley was trying to pick up, was it Matty Donnelly? You know, so very, very similar. So I think Tyrone would set up very similar to what they have done in that game and what they did in the Ulster final. For Kerry, yes, of course, Kerry are going to have to go at it and back their forwards to be, you know, to be on top of their game and to get the scores to win the game. But Kerry are going to have to not play overly defensive, but they're going to have to be very careful that it, when they're high up the field, when they're attacking Tyrone, that when the move breaks down, which it will do at some stages, that they're not caught on the hop down the other side of the field, that they have cover. So I think their midfield is going to play a big part in that. David Moran, whether it's David Moran and Dermot O'Connor, David Moran and Jack Barry, they're going to have to play a little bit more defence-minded when we lose the ball. But look, I would still expect Kerry to come with, you know, attack is the best form of defence. I can see us reverting back to what we saw Kerry go with above in Croke Park, or sorry, above in Páirc Uí Chaoimh last year against Cork, where we were very conservative. We played with defensive wing forwards. I think we're really, really buzzing at the moment, particularly our forward unit. And Croke Park is made for good, fast forwards, accurate forwards. So I think we won't see a huge variation in Kerry's style, but I think they will have to keep an eye on the way Tyrone break and play that direct ball into one-on-one situations in front of our goals. They'll have to come up with something to make sure that they minimise the threat there.
It sounds to me like you fancy Kerry to win this game.
Oh, I do. I do, Oisin, yeah. And I know the layoff obviously has to be taken into account, but I just think Kerry are in a situation now where they're just really confident and, you know, they're firing on all cylinders. They're going to have their work cut out for them. Of course they are. Tyrone at the end of the day. And I know they've had their difficulties, but listen, whatever 15 they put out in the field are going to be proud Tyrone men, and they're going to come with everything they have to make it very, very difficult for Kerry. They won't read too much into the league game in Killarney. They'll be putting that out of their minds. They've had a very good Ulster Championship. They've got some really, really good tests. That's definitely an advantage they'll have over Kerry. You know, Tyrone have had some really, really good tough battles to get to an All-Ireland semi-final. Kerry have waltzed through the Munster Championship and throw in the layoffs, then, you know, it will take Kerry maybe a little bit to get going. I know Tyrone have had the layoff, but they have had the benefit of those difficult Ulster Championship games. So it, from that point of view, it's a little bit, you know, it could be anybody's game, but, you know, if right being right, I just think Kerry will have too much on the day, hopefully.
This is one of these ridiculous questions that it's kind of a meaningless question, and I'm not sure anyone outside of Mayo can give us the answer. Anyone outside the Mayo camp, that is. But who do you think Mayo would prefer in the final?
Kerry.
Why?
Because I think it will be a more open game. I think they will feel that they have Kerry's number. I think Tyrone would be too much of an unknown quantity for them in certain ways. I think Tyrone would come with a lot more of a defensive setup. And I definitely think Mayo deep down feel that they do have Kerry's number in a lot of positions. I think they will look at the matchups and feel they have the advantage in a lot of positions on the field. So I personally think that they would love to take on Kerry. And there's the little bit of history as well in terms of, oh, you know, Mayo can never do it against Kerry in a final. I think that's another little thing that James Horne would use to motivate his guys if it was a Kerry-Mayo final. So they won't say it, but I firmly believe that Mayo would prefer to play Kerry in the final, yeah.
Sean, really appreciate your time. Congratulations to you and Cremaine for a great win during the week. And enjoy. Are you going up to Croke Park or will you watch it on TV?
No, I'm going up, Oisin. I'll tell you, I was remarking to one of the lads yesterday evening, I've changed trains so many times now. I could work for Irish Rail in their customer service department, I think. But no, I'm all sorted. So I'm going up and down on the train on tomorrow. So I'm looking forward to it. And hopefully we get over the line and we can go booking a train again for September the 11th with the help of God.
You might have an All-Ireland final coming down the tracks. Sean O'Sullivan, former Kerry footballer, four-time All-Ireland winner with Kerry. Thanks for joining us on the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast.
Thanks, Oisin.
This is the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast. Electric Ireland has teamed up with former Cork minor footballer Paul Kerrigan to highlight the major impact of the minor championships and to look ahead to this weekend's All-Ireland minor football final between Meath and Tyrone, which takes place at 1 o'clock on Saturday in Croke Park. The game will be live on TG Cahir with coverage beginning at 12:30. Paul Kerrigan, you are the Electric Ireland minor championship ambassador, and talk to me about your own time as a minor. What kind of minor were you?
Yeah, I suppose very enjoyable time. I suppose it's your first major milestone, let's say, as a footballer. You want to become an inter-county minor. I would have been a young minor. I would have been born in December, so maybe slightly less developed than some of the lads. And I would have played 2 years minor, so I've been quite young being a minor. And look, I would have been very much kind of happy to be a minor, and it would have been a goal of mine. I suppose we weren't too successful over the 2 years in terms of winning trophies and winning big games. But I suppose as you look back, you know, it was very much a platform for developing friendships and maybe getting a look at what that standard was and what I needed to improve on. And I think it definitely served me well from a personal point of view in terms of making friends and making connections that I still have today. And maybe I didn't probably even see the benefits of being an inter-county minor until maybe I was maybe 20, 21, and maybe I felt I belonged to that level then. But very enjoyable time, and I think it's a huge honour when you're that age to represent your county and to play in places like Croke Park, Páirc Uí Chaoimh, Killarney. It's a huge honour for maybe your family, your club and your community.
You always look confident on the ball when you had it in hand for Nemo Rangers in Cork, and people will know your style as one of perpetual motion, just continually running up and down the pitch. And you always look, as I say, confident. Now, that's a different thing to being cocky, but you always look confident. Did you always have that level of confidence, or did you have to learn that at minor? Did that develop as a county minor? Where did that come from?
I definitely didn't have it as a county minor. I would have been a bit unsure looking back now. Would have took great confidence that managers picked me to certain teams as a young fella. But maybe, as I said, I was always kind of quick on the ball. So as a younger fella, maybe try to get up and down the wings. I suppose I wouldn't have been cocky at all that time. I would have been happy and confident that the managers picked me to do a job and I was able. But I suppose it was it's a different kettle of fish compared to what it is now. It was very much you and your man standing out in the wing, and you try beat him or else you try track him. That would have been my job. So definitely wouldn't have the confidence, I suppose. Learned a lot as a minor. I would have been taken off in an All-Ireland semi-final pretty early in the first half. So that knocked the confidence maybe out of me a bit. And it took me a while to get over that as a young lad. But as I said, I think it served me well going along and maybe built up that resilience that helped me pushing forward in my GA career.
And of course, we're building up to the Electric Ireland All-Ireland minor final. But for all minors, and including yourself here, if you were to maybe give yourself advice at that age, what would that advice be? Would it be, look, even if you get a blow like that, stay confident, keep working, don't worry about it, it happens? Or what would your advice be?
Yeah, going back to your point, I kind of encourage myself to back myself that bit more. Do you know what I mean? I think I was very much maybe a guy who would be very much a team player. Do you know, if a guy was going through, maybe get out of his way or maybe track back things you have to do, but maybe back myself more to get on the ball and express myself maybe a little bit more as a younger lad. I think I was I would have been kind of a good team player, but maybe to be that bit more selfish and go look for the ball and try to make things happen rather than maybe a guy win the ball and hand it to me. Do you know what I mean? Maybe to show that bit more confidence in the back of myself. When you look at some of the minors now and the way they move with purpose and they look so strong and fit, you're saying, geez, was I anywhere near that when I was that age? So that would be my advice really to the lads, to go out and back themselves, especially in a big game now that they've won their provincial finals, won two very good semis. So in the final, go and do that.
And before we get to the game itself, you're a teacher. You've actually worked with Cork Minors this year in the last couple of years. They tend to be now well-rounded young fellas, don't they? I mean, they tend to be, you know, good at sport, but also, more importantly, they're good people and they concentrate on their studies as well. And it is important to have that kind of rounding and grounding, isn't it?
Yeah, I suppose I'm coming up kind of nearly on 10 years secondary teaching, and I've seen a lot of the inter-county minors come and go, playing with some of them now with my club. And we've had lads on the hurling and football panels this year, and you can see how driven they are. You know, they're using our gym facilities, our pitch facilities to after school to better themselves and get their programs done, which was great to see. And I found generally the guys who are kind of the most balanced are the guys who have a goal, whether it be a college course or to get a trade after school, and they have that focus to concentrate and get whatever points they need and balance that with the training that they're doing. I've just kind of found that they're kind of the guys who do the best, and it's great to see. And their peers, their fellow students look up to that, you know, which is great. And as a teacher and like a bit of a secondary school coach, you get great pride in seeing them achieve, whether it be academically or on the sporting field, whether it be playing with their clubs or, you know, really with representing Cork, which is a great thing to see.
Is there anything that makes you feel as old as when you're in the training room and someone you're teaching or a minor lad comes in, you just feel like you're 100 years old? I remember it now. Granted, this is junior F night at your level of senior football, but I remember one of the young fellas came in for a match wearing his school uniform, and I was like, "Why? What is going on here? How did I get so old? How do you feel when you see that?" And these young fellas coming in there.
Yeah, I'm training with Nemo now and some of my past pupils, and you're sitting down and you're talking about Love Island, and then you're going home to Harris saying, Jesus, what? Like, these lads are...
Are you talking about it and joining the conversation, or are you just listening? Are you a Love Island fan?
Joining, yeah, and listening, okay. And you're saying, Jesus, like, where are we going? But it is great to see him grow up. Like, so, there's very few, I suppose, I've played with while I was still teaching, and maybe one or two, so not too many. But they come into our panels then maybe the next year or two after that once they're gone. And generally all good lads, and it's great to see them, and they're to see them be successful with our club team now and win their own county medals is great to see, and it's great to be playing with them still.
Now, you hope Love Island won't be like the Cork County final this weekend. A long build-up, a long wait for the final, and then it turns out to be disappointing. So I'm told, don't watch it, genuinely. But you've had to wait a long time for this county final, Cork, Nemo Rangers against Castlehaven. How does that change the build-up, the fact that it's been such a kind of a strange and unique build-up, and it's no one's fault, it's just the way it was. But how does that change the build-up for you to a normal county final?
Yeah, it's a strange, like... We won the semi on a Sunday and we're supposed to be playing the following Sunday. The next thing was pulled midweek. And then I think it was supposed to be in January and it was pulled again. And then I think it was March maybe. And then start to June. And then it kept being pushed back, I suppose, to the Cork teams, both under-20s and seniors being successful. And it wasn't until, let's say, Cork beat Kilkenny in the All-Ireland Assembly, we got a final date, which is this weekend. So it's been strange. Very low-key build-up around the city and county, because obviously the Cork senior hurlers were in the All-Ireland final. From our point of view, I suppose, we're treating it as a one-off game with Nemo, because let's say our season, 2021 season, starts only a week later. But what we're looking at is a lot of our lads have played in All-Ireland club semis and club finals, and we've been training for let's say, for a one-off game. So we'll be using that experience to hopefully give us the edge next weekend. But look, it's a county final, and they mightn't come around too often. You don't know when it'll be your last one. So it's important that we get out and perform and bring the cup back to the club.
I'll say if, because it's a big if. It's two good teams. Would it mean as much given the circumstances and the fact that you're pretty much straight back into it the next weekend?
Yeah, it would. Like, it would mean a lot. Like, you know, I think it would mean a lot to the members as well, you know. Like, I suppose the restrictions are lifting a bit, so you might see some people back in the club, but only a certain amount indoors. So I think it would mean a lot to the people in the club. And look, we have a good rivalry with Castlehaven. They'd be from West Cork, we're from the city. We beat them in the county final 2015. They beat us in the county final 2013, and they beat us a couple of years ago. So there's been fairly ding dong battles between us the last couple of years. And traditionally, we'd be two big clubs and with a big rivalry when we play each other. So yeah, it will mean a lot, to be honest with you. You know, and we'll celebrate it accordingly if we win, and which you should do with always a county final victory.
And just before I let you go, what about the All-Ireland semi-final? I know you're probably not, after putting that much thought into it, given your own work to do this weekend, but Kerry against Tyrone, how do you see that one going? Or is it impossible to predict given the circumstances around the build-up?
No, I fancy Kerry, to be honest with you. I think from day one, I think if you can remember their very first league game in Tralee, they played Galway. I think they were just at it from day one, like their body language, they're pressing the kick out, their traditional interplay and kick passing has been added since day one. And they've dished out some hammerings right throughout the league and championship. You know, Galway at the Tyrone down in Killarney, and obviously Cork and Killarney in the championship. So I fancy Kerry, to be honest, which I know Tyrone have a lot of issues. I suppose I was speaking to someone recently who'd know someone in Tyrone camp, and they said they'd only maybe half the panel training some nights, guys who've maybe struggled very badly with the COVID, you know. So the problems are there for them, and I think Tyrone do have a good panel. They probably have the best panel in Ulster, so maybe they might be able to cope with it a little bit better than other teams. But I just think the way Kerry seem on a mission this year, and I just fancy him to win it this weekend.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Paul Kerrigan there, who has teamed up with Electric Ireland to highlight the major impact of the minor championships and to look ahead to this weekend's Electric Ireland Minor All-Ireland Football Championship final between Meath and Tyrone, which takes place at 1 o'clock on Saturday in Croke Park. The game will be live on TG Cahir with coverage beginning at 12:30. You'll probably be able to listen to you'll definitely be able to listen to that game on LMFM as well. Paul Kerrigan, thank you for joining us on the ExtraTime.com Friday podcast.
Thanks, William. Cheers.
Well, we're joined now by Ireland rugby captain Ciara Griffin, who has teamed up with Rugby Players Ireland Zurich and the Z Zurich Foundation to invite post-primary schools to take part in the 2021-2022 Tackle Your Feelings Schools Mental Wellbeing Programme as part of the hashtag I'm Taking Control campaign. The Tackle Your Feelings Schools Programme is a classroom-based, teacher-led life skills development program which enables students to build healthy habits and personal coping strategies, as well as kindness and understanding when it comes to mental health and well-being. How important is this program? And I'll sound like I'm kind of generalizing it, and I don't mean to, but how important is the whole field of health and well-being for school children?
It's so important, Oisin. Like, since lockdowns, you can see that they take effect on children's mental well-being, and in particular their interpersonal skills. So I think this program is a way of showing them that it's okay not to feel okay, and giving them, I suppose, the tools and techniques to, I suppose, express how they're feeling and learn ways, different coping mechanisms. But I think a big thing is it's helping take away the stigma about talking about your feelings and saying, actually, no, I don't feel okay. And feeling okay about that, and learning different ways and learning how to talk about it. I think that's so important. You know, like, a lot of kids, and you know, a lot of parents have said that their kids pay more attention to their physical health rather than their mental health. And if you look at the same, if you think of it like a scales, a balance scales, you need one for the other and vice versa. So I really think this campaign is going to kind of help get children talking more about their mental health.
Well, some of the research is really interesting. And this research was actually done in August of this year. So it's very, very recent. Only 48% of parents believe their children know the importance of mental well-being, and 15% say their child has missed school due to issues around mental health and well-being. 60% think schools need to do more to help children take control of their mental well-being, with 57% saying seeing role models like rugby players take control of their mental health inspires their children. So that's, I guess, one of the reasons why you're getting involved, Ciara, that kind of particular reason there, to be one of those role models and to put the message out there, you know what, it's okay to talk about it, it's okay to worry about it, it doesn't make you abnormal.
Yeah, completely, Oisin. That's the big thing, saying, look, it doesn't matter how, if you're a rugby player or anything else, or you're a person in the classroom, it's okay to talk about your feelings. And I think that's something that we all need to learn to do, as even as adults, that it's okay to say you're not okay, and to talk to your friends and share with your friends, because often a problem shared is a problem halved. And what I love about this campaign is it gives teachers the tools and resources to implement the wellbeing campaign. And like, you've eight lesson plans. You've eight lesson plans on it that will go through the different lessons, different objectives for every lesson, and what you want to get from it. The TYF app is really accessible. You know, you've a lot of schools now with the extra technology in schools have tablets, you know, so they can have the tablets on, you can have the app on the tablet, and you'll be able to use it even in your say your SPHE lesson or your wellbeing lesson. And it's just so important to make it more accessible. And I think the more children see the app or use the app or use and just see how accessible it is, they'll get more out of it.
And it's important as well that it's human led, it's teacher led, and teachers, they're probably in or around some of the most important people in society. They can really go to the students here and say, well, look, you know, they can even say it at the top of the class, look, if any of you want to talk to me about this or check this out, you can do so. And it gives them the choice as well. And it's great to have that kind of human face of it. And teachers are kind of a real authority figure for kids this age. So it's important that, you know, it's great that they're involved as well. It's not just a kind of, look, here's an app you can go to, check it out if you want to. It's actually, there's actually human interaction there as well.
Completely. I think it's really important as teachers that we facilitate this, and that we facilitate allowing children to experience it, experience different emotions and go through different feelings, and just saying, you know, teach them different coping mechanisms. Because like I teach younger age group, and often you see they are upset and they feel a certain way, but they have difficulty getting their feelings across in the right way in terms of explaining how they feel or what's wrong. And I just think it's so important that we, from a young age, that we instill children with the right vocabulary, with the right, just that it's okay to say how you're feeling, that you don't have to hide it. You're not going to get in trouble for being upset. You're not going to get in trouble for being angry, because we all feel angry at times. We all get upset. And especially since COVID in the last 18 months, like, our lives have been turned upside down, and particularly for children, you know, there, and for young adults, like, they've gone from being in school in a routine every day, 5 days a week, 6 or 7 hours, to all of a sudden being homeschooled and seeing their teacher online through Zoom, through Teams. It's such a shift in the norm for them. And obviously, like, that was difficult, because like you saw 50% of parents have said their child's interpersonal skills were affected during lockdown. And that just shows you how important now this campaign will be, because as teachers, we see kids the most. You know, we see them for 5-6 hours a day. So yeah. If we give them healthy habits, we already give them healthy habits in terms of their education, in terms of physical education or physical activity, but also to give them healthy habits in terms of their mental well-being. And I just think us, that we have such a role to play in this, and that being the role models, that it's okay to say, look, you're not okay, and it's okay, that's fine, and just talk to me. Or, you know, since COVID, a lot of schools have taken SPHE and mental well-being as a high area for our programs, and just focusing on that. And I think the more we focus on that, the more we help our children kind of come to the other side of this.
And another key point is they don't have to be like really down or on the extreme to talk about their feelings or to go and say, well, look, I need a bit of help here. It's actually really good, even if they're feeling fine, to talk about it, because that continual conversation is actually a good thing, isn't it?
Oh, completely. Like, and that's the thing, you don't have to just feel sad to come to say how you're feeling. You could be really happy, but like, tell me why you're happy, or tell us why you're happy. And you know, it's great to share that too, that, you know, it to show how you are happy, what makes you happy. And I just think it's so important that we get children or get young adults talking about their feelings and just getting rid of that stigma. And on the flip side, teaching their peers to listen. Do you know, I think that's so important. You can talk fine, but you need people on the other side to listen and to make it feel like they are listening. And I just think that's going to really help us going forward.
It certainly will. And I think if you talk about these things when your mental health is good, it actually helps you cope with that. You come up with good mechanisms and ways to find help when it's bad. Busy time coming up for you. World Cup qualifiers, Ciara. You must be really looking forward to them.
Yeah, busy now coming up, Oisin. We've had a busy summer in terms of training and preps, a lot of weekend camps under the belt. And September now, this month coming up, we have World Cup qualifiers in Italy. So we have a job of work to do there. Or obviously, we need to qualify for the World Cup. So that's our goal.
Is it good that it's essentially a tournament within itself? It's kind of all in one.
Yeah, completely. Like, it's for 16 days, we're gone away. You get that, so that environment, that it's like a mini cup in some extents, because you're away from your family, you're away from your loved ones, away from your country, and you're just focusing on your training. And we have a job to do, and that's what we're focused on doing.
I know it's a long time ago, but given what you did in the Six Nations, you won the matches you expected to win, and actually you can take positives out of the ones that you didn't. Is that good preparation? Is that the best way to be going into this?
Yeah, look, it was good preparation for us at the time in terms of trying different things and showing that we can get the results we want. Obviously, look, there was areas to tighten up on there. You know, we didn't perform as well as we wanted against some of the teams in different areas, but we had, which was good in a way, in terms it showed us what we needed to tighten up on over our summer program. So we worked hard in trying to fix those areas or fine tune them in terms of just fix them. And I think we're in a good state going forward now. Obviously, it's our first match since Six Nations. So, yeah, you know, we have to take that into mind as well in terms of how we prepare mentally to overcome that. So, looking forward to it.
And how difficult is that? The fact that, you know, you won't have a test match beforehand. It is straight into it.
I suppose that we've had a lot of internal games in camp, which, to be honest, are just as intense as any international match, which have been good for us in terms of, you know, getting new combinations and trying different things. So that gives us a level of confidence going into this block.
Okay, well, look, we all wish you the very best of luck with it. That, of course, Ireland rugby captain Ciara Griffin, who has teamed up with Rugby Players Ireland Zurich and the Z Zurich Foundation to invite post-primary schools to take part in the 2021-2022 Tackle Your Feelings Schools Mental Health Wellbeing Programme as part of the hashtag I'm Taking Control campaign. The Tackle Your Feelings Schools Programme is a classroom-based, teacher-led life skills development programme which enables students to build healthy habits and personal coping strategies, as well as kindness and understanding when it comes to mental health and well-being. Ciara Griffin, thanks for joining us.
Thanks very much.
Well, that's it for Friday. Don't forget, we're back on Monday when, among the highlights, will be a review of Bohemians against Shamrock Rovers in the FAI Cup. Aoife Mullen will be going to that game for us. We'll also look back on the Premier League weekend. Manchester City taking on Arsenal tomorrow. That's presuming you're listening to us on Friday. And also tomorrow, that's Saturday, obviously, Liverpool taking on Chelsea. On Sunday, there's an Old Firm derby between Rangers and Celtic in the Premiership, and we'll look back on that as well. As well as all that, there's the All-Ireland football semi-final between Kerry and Tyrone, and the All-Ireland Camogie semi-finals. It's a doubleheader in Croke Park on Sunday. Plus, in the SSE Airtricity Women's National League, Wexford Youths meeting Piemont, and Wexford have to win if they're to keep any hope of winning the title alive. Well, that's it for me. Don't forget, you can always find me on @OisinLangan. That's via Twitter. Until Monday, take care. Have a good weekend.